known as the DC-3, the Dakota, or the Goonie Bird, this aging but ageless aeroplane transformed the passenger aviation industry in the 1930s.
The aircraft in those days was really equivalent to the Concorde today. The Concorde is at least 20 years ahead of its time, and so was the DC-3.
When we came up with the DC-2 and the DC-3, it was the first time, I think, that we'd ever used wind tunnel data to design the airplane.
El DC-3 se puede comparar con un tractor. Con un tractor. Yo pienso que es irreemplazable. De pronto el avión que pueda reemplazarlo es el mismo DC-3 con turbina.
It wasn't a war machine at all, except, of course, it did an enormous job during the war. It just about did everything that it could possibly do. It was the real workhorse of the skies.
Nearly 60 years old, there are some 1,500 Dakotas still flying worldwide. In Britain, the Air Atlantic fleet stands prepared and ready for work.
Well, our particular operation is quite unique because we operate up to 10 Dakota aircraft at any one particular time. I think the main characteristic for using the Dakota in our operations is the fact that they are relatively cheap to buy. We use these aircraft for carrying anything from nuts and bolts through to livestock, to parcels, and even to newspapers. It doesn't take very long to convert one of these aircraft from its freight-carrying role into the passenger configuration, perhaps 3 to 4 hours at the very, very most. And we can install seats, and when the aircraft is in the passenger role, it looks very, very modern inside. We want to work an aircraft as much as possible because that means much less downtime in terms of engineering and maintenance. If an aircraft is used more, it tends to be more reliable.
The global trade has grown up around the Dakota.
I bought about 20 of them from all over the world. We've got them from the Danish Air Force, from the Spanish Air Force, operators in the Caribbean. Some of them can be neglected and sitting around on airfields for years, and others can be fresh out of service, especially the military ones, which are as good as new. This airplane has never been civilianized, and it's always been kept in its military configuration. It came over to this country during the war. It's been on the Arnhem run. It actually towed gliders over to Arnhem. It's got the cut-off tail area still on where the glider towing hook goes, and the aircraft survived the war. It also went on the Berlin airlift. Inside the aircraft, it has all its wartime fittings, and it could be worth $200,000. There are very few of them left in passenger service these days, but there's a great following for them in South America and places like that. There's a tremendous amount still in operational use.
La selva colombiana es inmenso el número de personas que viven trabajando allí, sí. Y así como es de grande el número, también están solicitando, están pidiendo, ¿sí? Y el único medio de transporte, ¿sí?, es aéreo, ¿sí?, y preferentemente por cuestiones económicas, ¿sí?
Colombians reckon that they went from the mule to the aeroplane in just one move. The vast and dense jungle interior is still without decent roads. Journeys that can take 4 or 5 days by car are only a couple of hours away in the DC-3. The history of these aeroplanes is closely tied to the development of passenger aviation. They taught the public to fly and helped the airlines to grow. Before the Dakota, government mail subsidies kept the airlines solvent. Passenger travel operated at a loss, since planes could only carry 6 to 8 cramped people.
Those airplanes were very noisy, and it was impossible to carry on a conversation in the cabin. And passengers usually had to wrap themselves in blankets to keep warm. And It was really considered, you were very daring to fly on an airline in those days. The public had very little confidence, and people used to make out their wills for flights just to go on a passenger flight from one place to the other.
The Dakota was designed by Donald Douglas, who had a small manufacturing company in Santa Monica, California. In 1932, Jack Fry of Transworld Airlines put out a tender for a new airplane to compete with the rival Boeings. One of the conditions was a three-motor design.
When Douglas engineers analyzed the requirements for this specification, they concluded that they could do the job with a two-engine airplane. So they came up with what was then called the DC-1.
It had a stressed aluminium skin design, which was light and immensely strong. But the 710 horsepower engines were thought to be insufficiently powerful. A special test was imposed by Transworld. The prototype DC-1 had to fly over the Rocky Mountains with one engine turned off and still have enough power to fly the plane safely. It succeeded.
When we got an order from TWA to build the DC-1, we extended the length of the fuselage slightly and changed the passenger capability from 12 to 14. And we increased the power and we increased the speed, and so it was basically the same aerodynamic airplane, but it had a little longer fuselage.
The production model was called the DC-2. Transworld ordered 25 immediately, a huge order in those days. The plane broke long-distance records and proved safe and reliable. It was in demand by airline companies worldwide. By 1935, new radio navigation aids made night flying possible, so a wider-bodied sleeper version of the DC-2 was developed for American Airlines. The night berths needed more space, and this was exploited on daytime flights in a new version, the DC-3.
When we built the fuselage to accommodate the sleeper berths, then we could have put a whole extra row of seats. So instead of two abreast seating, we had three abreast seating. So instead of 14 passengers, now we had 21 passenger capability. The operating cost of the DC-3 was not much greater than that of the DC-2. We had a little more horsepower and burned a little more fuel, but we had really increased the payload capabilities so much that now the airlines could operate this airline on passenger load alone and make a profit.
DC-3 made passenger flight commercially viable for the first time. It became the most glamorous, successful, and popular plane in civil aviation history. By 1939, the DC-3 was carrying virtually all world airline traffic, and the passengers loved it. It was a dream image that the Douglas factory could barely keep up with.
The procedures used in manufacturing, the tooling was very limited at that time, and a lot of the work on assembling the part was done by the mechanic. We had expert mechanics in the shop at that time, and so even the drawings didn't cover what the part should look like, and the man in the shop would say, well, the drawing says this has to be modified, and he had a little black book, and when he'd build the part, well, the drawing wouldn't cover the situation, he'd look in his black book to know how to produce the part.
A larger plane could make bigger profits, but the ambitions of the Douglas factory and the airlines were overtaken by events. With the coming of war, the United States Army Air Corps commissioned a heavy-duty version of the DC-3 and called it the C-47. At peak production, 50 planes were made a week at factories in Santa Monica, Long Beach, and Oklahoma City. Over 10,000 C-47s were built in all, mostly by a new and inexperienced workforce. Rosie the Riveter was the propaganda title bestowed on the heroines of the production line.
I was a Rosie the Riveter, one of the earliest ones. I worked on the C-47, and my first job was to put on these nut plates on these four gas tank covers.
We used a lot of housewives and shoe salesmen and drug clerks to build the airplane. So we had to design tooling that they couldn't make a mistake. With the jig, everything was precisely located, and the housewife that never had built an airplane before could put her drill in this jig and drill the holes in the proper location.
The only electrical thing that we'd used was a vacuum cleaner or an electric iron. So we had to learn how to do this, and it was hard work. These are brazier head rivets, and these are what the entire C-47 is made of. They're a round head rivet, and then your rivet gun fits over that so that you can shoot them, and then somebody behind you holds a metal bar, and they flatten them down.
That's my notebook I kept when I went to the aircraft school when I came to work for Douglas Aircraft in 1942. I was surprised what a good artist I was. This is how the rivet should look. That's a perfect one. That one's clinched. I think I had the most experience as a nut plate putter on her than anybody in history. I did them for years.
Completed planes were dispatched to Allied Europe. It was at this time that the British began to call them Dakotas, after the state from which many of them left America. On arrival in Britain, the planes were distributed to RAF bases by a civil organization, the Air Transport Auxiliary.
I was in the ATA, or the Air Transport Auxiliary at the time, and the chief test pilot and I had to deliver the first aircraft, but before we could do that, we had to write the handing note because we didn't have any training on the aircraft. We was just given a ferry chit and an aeroplane to move, and we found as many technical documents that we could on board and sort of worked it out for ourselves and literally did a flight test on the delivery flight so that we could leave the handling notes behind, so to speak, for the other ferry pilots to fly the aeroplane. And it was all done with pieces of paper and no hands-on training.
It was as a supply carrier that the Dakota excelled. Transport Command used it to fly in equipment, personnel, and rations wherever they were needed. The heavy build of the C-47 made it ideally suited to makeshift airfields.
In Normandy, for example, we were landing there about 10 days or so after the D-Day, and the army had bulldozed strips out into the sandy soil that was out there, and of course it was pretty rough, but the Dakota coped with it extremely well. It had a very robust undercarriage. It was an airplane that you could land on rough strips and do short landings, but it also was an airplane that was very easy to put down the ground very, very gently, because of course when you've got casualties on board, it's very essential that you try as much as possible to ease their pain.
With paratroopers aboard, Dakota crews were subjected to even greater risks.
When we were flying into Arnhem, of course, we were going along with a lot of colleagues, and you were flying along in a stream. Things were quite reasonable until you got near the dropping zone, well, when very considerable amounts of flak came up at you, and there was a slightly different hazard in which we were flying at about 1,000 feet, but above us were some Stirlings at about 1,800 feet, and one right in front of me, I recall seeing a streamer, which is a pannier with the parachute didn't open, and it knocked the tail off a Dakota in front of me, and it went straight in. It was a very terrifying experience.
Immediately after the war, wherever there was tension, the partition of India or the Berlin airlift, the Dakota was there in force. It had to be because there were more of them than anything else. But by the late 1940s, there was a glut of ex-military Dakotas on the market, providing a green light for some.
I had a big spare parts operation. I had 6,000 items. And one item, for example, would have been 6,000 aeroplane engines. And so I had a lot of parts for the DC-3 or stroke C-47. In fact, the only thing that ever seemed to go wrong with the aeroplane was the spark plugs. So we kept plenty of spark plugs and magnetos, of course. I owned one C-47 stroke DC-3. And I can remember its registration number now, it was GAMSR. I bought it, the one from the Air Force government surplus, for £7,000. And if I can remember rightly, I sold it for £30,000, which was quite a big profit in those days.
There was also money to be made converting Dakotas for civilian use. Entrepreneurs transformed the freighter into a people carrier, often with an increase in seating capacity from the original 21 to 28. New companies like Sir Freddie Laker's Air Charter revived the DC-3's passenger role.
We were using them between Blackpool and the Isle of Man. It was called Manx Airways and Jersey Airlines. So we went on with them for many, many years and carried hundreds and hundreds of thousands of passengers.
Well, it was great novelty. Very few people had flown. I would say 90% of people hadn't flown. So as we used to get them on board, a lot of them were shaking, very, very nervous. Then we used to have to load them from the back, because on this type of aeroplane, you probably realize I'm walking uphill. If everybody loaded at the front, it would tip on its nose. So I used to walk up the cabin, blocking it as they went, so that people had to sit where I told them. And they all used to scream on takeoff, clutch each other, and then get very, very excited about the views. We used to have a regular run about once a week up to Thurso, which was taking atomic scientists from Manchester, and we used to fly to Wick. And we used to pick up the meal trays out of Manchester. When we got to Wick, there were no facilities at all. I used to have to take all my washing up in a box down to the local restaurant, and they did the washing up for me. We had a deal up there with the fire brigade, and they used to come and clean the aircraft out for us. I had a float, and I used to go around the shops and buy ham and salad and bread rolls and cheese. And in this very tiny space at the back, I had to make up about 26 meal trays. And then I'd go to the restaurant, pick up my flasks of coffee. We'd come up here. The passengers would arrive. The crew would load the baggage. I would sort them out. And, of course, I'd have to do the load sheet as well.
Demand for larger aeroplanes carrying more passengers brought the manufacture of the DC-3 to an end in 1946. Jet technology, with its improved reliability, reduced maintenance and greater power, displaced the Dakota in the developed world. In the 1960s, South America and Africa received large numbers of DC-3s, both as cast-offs from the big airlines and as government aid from the Americans. Many of them were sent to Bogota, the capital of Colombia. Today, 30 years later in the Colombian interior, ex-military Dakotas, with their cargo doors, heavy-duty airframes and carrying capacity, remain perfectly suited to local needs.
Trabajando de la manera que se trabaja aquí, llegando con la carga que estamos llegando, o sea, con los 3,000 kilos que pudimos llegar a una pista corta, relativamente, bastante llena de obstáculos, de huecos, ¿sí? De baches, ¿sí? Es difícil la operación de cualquier otro tipo de avión.
No, eso, allá no se produce nada de comida. Allá no hay productos como la papa o el arroz, eso no se consigue allá nada. Toca llevarlo todo.
De víveres, como te dije, se consume mucho licor. En la selva se consume mucha cerveza, mucho aguardiente. Le llamamos aguardientes de medio, casi de whisky, ustedes. Se consume mucho combustible también, se consume.
Fly to save time, Colombians fly to survive. Whole families use the planes as shuttles between market towns and their homes in the jungle. Nubia Alvarez flies over this terrain four times a week. Her 50-year-old DC-3 remains viable as a commercial aeroplane. because it is so robust. The plane's hallmark is the strength of its wing, which does not suffer the fatigue that has grounded all of its contemporaries. At the foothills of the Andes, Villa Vicencio is the traditional gateway to the Colombian southeast. And it's not just an old aeroplane's graveyard. Companies like Alianza, run by Jorge Alvarez, provide all the backup needed to keep these aging DC-3s in the air. The family business, shared with his sister Nubia, was inherited from their father and brother, who both died in flying accidents. Along with their own two DC-3s, they run an engineering workshop which services the other 16 Dakotas in town.
Pienso yo que radicarán la aviación de pistón de Bogotá y el único centro, el único lugar donde puedan recibir toda esa aviación, toda esa infraestructura que tiene Bogotá de pistón sería Villavicencio. Porque prácticamente el 50% de nuestra aviación depende generalmente de los motores, de las reparaciones, del costo, ¿sí? Y Villavicencio es el centro de mayor operación de este tipo de aviones.
The 14-cylinder Pratt & Whitney engines are looked after with real devotion.
El motor sale para una reparación general de 1,000 horas, pero al motor le hacen reparaciones parciales, o sea, en servicios periódicos, de 100 horas, de 200, de 400, 500 horas. Y es mi pasión. En realidad, cuando uno ya le coge el tiro, pues, se hace parte de uno. Bueno, yo una vez tuve la oportunidad de trabajar en turbinas y la rechacé. No me gustaba, muy sencilla. Se prácticamente se aburre uno trabajando en turbinas. Porque el mismo trabajo es el mismo siempre.
Maintenance of the undercarriage is vital. It's the landing gear's balloon tires which enable the planes to use unprepared airstrips. The old-fashioned tail-dragger design of the DC-3 is less susceptible to tipping up on its nose than the modern tricycle setup.
Con pistas muy malas, pistas no pavimentadas, en greda, en grama, en gravilla, en lodo, lo que sea, piedra. Y la única fuente de ingreso por la carga, por lo grande, el DC-3.
Landing strips don't come much tougher than the one in Miraflores, where the high street doubles up as a runway. A town with as many bars and brothels as houses, it is home to some 2,000 people. Here, the DC-3 acts as a mobile corner shop. It brings in everything from the football pools to prostitutes. Strip is controlled by the anti-narcotics police by day and the guerrillas by night. It's a volatile cocktail that ends in murder most weekends. The DC-3 used all the most advanced innovations of its time, But the structure, aerodynamics and engine are now nearly 60 years old.
One thing you notice in comparing it with later designed airplanes is that the control forces on a heavy are heavier on a three. The aileron forces at higher speeds, you feel like the controls are buried in cement. They're so hard to turn.
Hay gente que piensa que yo debo tener unos músculos muy grandes o una fuerza tenaz en los pies porque se supone que son aviones para hombres.
¿Y no es así?
No. Los aviones son muy suaves.
Yeah, if you do a side slip in it, the rudder forces go very, very light, and in fact, they overbalance, and you get what we call a rudder lock. The side slip is very uncomfortable for passengers. It throws them all to one side of the seat, and you're not in a balanced flight condition.
No es muy difícil operarlo, no es fácil tampoco operarlo, ¿sí? Sobre todo como se opera aquí en este sector, en este llano, en esta selva, ¿sí? Por las características tanto del tiempo, climáticas, como geográficas.
In an age where planes are built with a limited flying life, the Dakota has an unequaled record in durability and hours flown. It has never been directly replaced.
We built the one aeroplane. We called it the Accountant. Why, I will never know. It was a DC-3 replacement. And of course, it was pressurized. It was much faster and with a longer range. That was the theory of it. And I couldn't get any government support for it. And I just couldn't afford it. It was going to cost £5 million to put it into production. And I'd already spent £750,000 of my own money. So I thought, well, we'll bite this particular bullet as much as I dislike it. And I broke it up for scrap.
We found out that it was very hard to design an airplane that would do a job for its within its range that the DC-3 did. And now it carries, for a short-range operation, it carries about as good a payload as anything you can buy today.
Vaya como tú.
Me siento volando el DC3. Yo me siento realizada ahorita como piloto. Me siento realizada. Me gusta mucho el DC3. Estoy muy, muy encariñada con él. Es un avión muy, muy noble. He tenido muchas emergencias con él y me ha ido muy bien.
I'm a very great fan of the Dakota. I flew them for about 1,300 hours during the war. And just looking at the airplane, it looks right. And it's, in my experience, airplanes that look right are right, and the Dakota certainly fits that bill.